For years, grieving families had been begging for an inquiry into Aboriginal deaths in custody. In 1987, they finally got it.
We have to find out why and what needs to be done to ensure that it doesn't happen again.
The final report into 99 deaths in custody found their Aboriginality played a significant and, in most cases, dominant role in their being in custody and dying in custody. Fact is, Indigenous people were grossly overrepresented in custody. One of the biggest reasons for this was social, economic, and cultural inequality. And since then, there have been at least 455 deaths. When the Royal Commission handed down its report, Indigenous people made up 14% of the prison population. Today, it's 28%. 339 recommendations were finally made, including that imprisonment only be a last resort, officers have ready access to medical assistance, and the offence of public drunkenness be abolished.
I was very optimistic that we would see a huge impact.
Before he was a Labor senator, Pat Dodson was the Royal Commission's first Indigenous commissioner. 3 decades on, he's still waiting for many of the recommendations to be fully implemented.
Well, I'm terribly disappointed and frustrated that this is a classic failure of leadership and accountability and a lack of responsiveness to problems that we all know about and have been told about by the Royal Commission some 30 years ago.
People are continuing to lose their lives in custody. These aren't just numbers. These are our elders, mothers, fathers, sisters, brothers and children.
Within the jail system, they're not even looked at as people. I think that they're looked at as animals.
Michaela and Talia Reynolds' brother, Nathan, died of an asthma attack in 2018, just 1 week before he was due to be released from prison in Sydney. Last month, the coroner concluded the prison's health response was confused, uncoordinated and unreasonably delayed.
The first officers that got to him, they didn't touch him. So it was the inmates that were there caring for him and, you know, trying to get him to breathe and comfort him and stuff like that. He was not given the proper health care that, as a human, you're entitled to.
These guards still have their jobs. This nurse that didn't act adequately for Nathan is still a nurse.
People often say if you break the law, you should be in prison. What's your response to them?
What I say to those people is that you don't know their struggles. You don't know what they've been through. Not everyone that goes into jail is a bad person.
What's been the hardest thing to come to terms about with the loss of Nathan?
I won't get to see him again. Won't have the interactions, and it saddens me that he doesn't get to watch his daughter grow up.
In the past month, there were no less than 5 Indigenous deaths in custody. They're painful reminders of the same trauma that prompted the Royal Commission.
What is it going to take? What more do they need? We've done inquest after inquest, given recommendations. When are you going to start listening?
I get really upset just knowing that I've lost Mum, you know, nearly 4 years ago and that nothing's changed and there's absolutely no outrage from the rest of Australia.
April's mum died in a Victorian police cell in 2017. Tanya Day was arrested for public drunkenness after being found asleep on a train.
Mum started to fall pretty much immediately, and one of them falls was to the front of her head on the concrete wall, and it caused a traumatic brain bleed. And they didn't enter that cell once to check on her, and she died 17 days later at the St Vincent's Hospital in Melbourne.
The coroner found police should have sought medical help sooner.
We want the people to be held responsible for our mum dying in their care.
It's not the first time April's family has suffered the pain of a death in custody. Her mum's uncle, Harrison Day, died in 1982 from an epileptic seizure in a police lockup after being arrested for an unpaid $10 fine for public drunkenness.
He was one of the cases that was included in the Royal Commission into Aboriginal Deaths in Custody, and that's the recommendation that had actually come out to abolish public drunkenness, which obviously that didn't happen because nearly 30 years on, Mum was arrested for the same law.
The Victorian government has this year finally agreed to scrap that law, but it's still on the books in Queensland. Reform in this country can be a slow process.
What does justice look like to you?
no more deaths in custody, people to be held accountable for what they do. No one has ever been held accountable for any of these deaths in custody.
The families of those who've died are demanding that all of the Royal Commission's recommendations be adopted. After 30 years, they've waited long enough.
I do hope that my kids don't have to experience the same struggle and fight, because I don't wish this on anybody.
I think we need more of Australia to stand up and go, enough's enough. We need more people to stand up with us.
In 30 years, it just feels like we've got absolutely nowhere on this issue. In 2019, 18% of people who died in custody were Indigenous, even though Indigenous people only make up 3% of the population. And around the same time, a survey was done. On an average night, young Indigenous Australians aged 10 to 17 were 21 more likely to be in detention than non-Indigenous Australians. I mean, those numbers don't lie.
We saw it on the sign there in the protest, the most incarcerated people in the world. How is that not our biggest, greatest national shame?
Yeah. It is absolutely our greatest national shame. I really do believe that. I mean, there was statistics that came out of the Northern Territory that showed that every single child that was incarcerated in the Northern Territory was Indigenous. How is that in any way okay? And we've known this for such a long time, and people think that progress is linear. You know, oh, well, I'm sure that people are doing much better now than what they were 50 years ago. I mean, are they? We saw in that report 14% of the population was Aboriginal, of the prison population was Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander. Now it's 28%. Is that better? No.
From expert opinions to in-depth analysis and reporting, the Project YouTube brings you the biggest stories from Australia and around the globe. Hit the subscribe button now for news delivered straight to your feed.